How do you see countries transitioning from existing screening programs to HPV-based programs?
So thank you, Madam Chair. First, I want to say what an honor it is to be able to participate in this launch of the new cervical cancer prevention guidelines. But also, I want to echo what my great friend Lynette Denny just talked about. And I do agree with her. No matter how much technology we have, and no matter how effective it is, and no matter what performance level it operates at, we won't get very far unless we put this disease and the women who have it in the proper social context. And it deserves a movement. And that's the only thing that's going to drive this off the planet is a social movement, because it is a social disease. So let me just briefly preface my thoughts about transitioning to HIV testing by saying, I think if you already have a cytology or VIA-based program or some combination of the two, I don't think it's wise to end it, as some people are recommending a rapid end to it under the banner of what they are calling de-implementation. I think instead, this opportunity to implement these new guidelines should be used to build on the screening platforms that you and your countries innovatively created using local knowledge, local intelligence, experience, and wisdom. Otherwise, you stand the chance of interrupting the screening services that you do have, confusing women in the community in the process, and potentially demoralizing health providers, making them think that they've done something wrong or bad or harmful to patients, when in fact, they were simply using what it was that they had, what was available to try to screen women and treat disease that they discovered. So my thoughts on how to catalyze this transition to HPV testing. And it's going to, as Mike Chirinji said in the last session, it's going to take time, and different countries will go about it differently, and the time frames will be different depending on your local situations. But first, I would perform a quick and thorough and brutally, and I say brutally because we often overinflate our achievements. And so in this particular case, we really need to be honest about what we have been able to achieve, the strengths and weaknesses of the present programs that we have, what they've been able to accomplish, and what has failed and why. Then after we've performed the assessment, and it shouldn't take long to do that, several months maybe, I think we need to really go about radically changing, and I mean radically, definitively changing those aspects of the program that have not worked, preserving and strengthening those aspects that have worked, and then building in the missing components. And this is really all about health system strengthening. We hear that term a lot, but you know, the question is, what is that? What does that mean? And so I think if we start trying to build in some of these missing components, I think we'll see what that really means on a ground floor level. So one, I think we can rapidly, or you should rapidly, we should rapidly go about reconfiguring our IEC materials. You heard the advocate HIV, the woman who was beautifully explained her difficulties in going through an experience with both HIV and HPV. And she raised some of the questions that need to be answered. What is HPV and that her mother was concerned about? Where does it come from? Can I give it to somebody else? Can I give it to my children? Will it prevent me from getting pregnant, or will it harm my baby if I become pregnant? We need to, as Lynn said, listen to what women are asking and then form the IEC materials around those critical questions to try to increase uptake. then there's this stigma that's associated with having a positive HPV test. And that needs to be addressed. And again, these are all in communities that every time they turn around, they're hearing about a disease that they have. First it was cholera and malaria, now then it was HIV and TB, now it's COVID. Now we're talking about now HPV is a problem. And so they are exhausted and tired of hearing about all of these negative things about them. So this has to be put in a framework of healthcare and trying to keep women alive and not some, you know, this negativity about disease and cancer, but it has to be truthfully presented, but in a positive framework. Provider education is something that has to be done, and it needs to be done quickly. Local experts, with the assistance of lots of people, you know, who've been on these committees, I'm sure would be very happy to help you. But local experts need to establish nationwide educational seminars to inform the frontline health providers, healthcare providers, of the new treatment algorithms, the new eligibility criteria, because they have changed. They're similar, but a lot of the terminology has changed. We're talking about TZ or transformation zone types. They need to understand what that is. That term comes out of colposcopy, and most of these countries, low-income countries, don't have colposcopy available, so it's a new terminology. Then there are the new patient follow-up guidelines, HIV positive, HIV negative. They need to become aware of this. Procurement is where I think we lose a lot. You can, in many countries, you can, providers can give you a list of things that they need. And by the time they go through this porous dark hole that's called a procurement system, what they get back is often not what they need. It's not the amount, it's not the quality. They may order 10 speculums and they end up with two, and they're of poor quality. They may order 5 loops to perform lets and they end up with one size of a loop. They may order something to help control bleeding and it's never delivered. They may order lignocaine with epinephrine to help control bleeding during a leap of lets and that's not delivered, or the needles are not there. And so we need to really take and the prices of some of these things when they're ordered are sometimes quadrupled over what they really cost. And why is that? We need to get into these procurement systems and figure out how to make them work well, how to make them transparent so that the providers have what they need all the time. Referral systems, it's another big problem. Something that needs to be strengthened rapidly. We lose patients who test HPV positive and we can't get them back in for triage or eligibility tests. We lose patients, and a significant number of patients who are HIV positive will test HPV positive, and a significant number of those will need LEAP or LETs. And we lose half of those patients when they're referred. And then there are 3-4% of HIV positive patients who come in for screening that they're HIV positive, and they have a lesion. They may, 3-4% of them may end up having invasive cancer. And we lose those patients to follow up. So we need to tighten up the holes in the referral systems. I know we're talking about self-testing, and self-testing is a great step. But that test, once it is obtained by that patient, still needs to be taken to a lab. And that lab needs to analyze that HPV test. And then the results need to get back to the clinic in a timely fashion. The same thing with the tissue that's removed at the time of biopsy or lets. And if that's not done efficiently, The providers become, they lose confidence in the system. The patients come back several times and they lose confidence in the system. And then sometimes we lose them in follow-up. So the laboratory infrastructure, those holes need to be tightened up. And then we need to work on developing a focused, lean, and manageable monitoring and evaluation system that can assess all of these things that I just mentioned, and that responds and that measures the indicators so that programmatic modifications can be made, and also research, practical research can be done. And then there's this link between HIV care and cervical cancer screening. It is a low-hanging fruit, and we have not worked to tighten up that linkage. Women that are coming in for HIV care, my opinion is that cervical cancer screening should be moved to the level, have the same priority as a viral load, to make sure that those women are screened. And then lastly is the transition to population-based screening. All of this needs to be put under it needs to be folded into population, trying to move from opportunistic to population-based screening. That's the only way we're going to get the coverage that we need. It's a tall order, and I think WHO is in a great position to help countries understand what population-based screening might mean in their individual settings. So those are the things that I would recommend that can be done now that can catalyze rapidly the transition to HPV testing. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Parham. And thank you all of you for those stimulating talks. We can all certainly understand that adopting and scaling up these recommendations offers many opportunities for saving women's lives. But there are also more programs and implementation considerations.